Dear Jewel, I left you with a few things to always hold on to. Loyalty, elusiveness, and brute force.
You're watching the GameSpot Co-op stage, sponsored by LEGO Star Wars: The Force Awakens.
What's up, everybody? Welcome to E3 2016 on the GameSpot Co-op stage. I'm one of your hosts, Greg Miller from Kinda Funny, alongside the Pride of Long Island from Kinda Funny, Colin Moriarty.
Good to be here.
Over there, Chris Waters from GameSpot.com.
Hello.
And right here, David Cage. David Cage! You son of a bitch, did that game look good at that press conference. Oh, let me shake your hand.
Oh,
Detroit, become human. Good Lord, sir. You know what a fan of Heavy Rain I was. And I let you lull me into a false sense of confidence. Because when I saw the demo, you see Kara, I was like, oh, she's the playable character. Totally makes sense. And then here we go. Another AI pops up, and we're going to be playing as him. Are there more? Are there more playable characters? Is it that much like Heavy Rain? What's happening?
Who knows?
God damn it. You know. You've been working.
You wrote the game, sir.
How long have you been working on Detroit?
Oh, too long, my God. Too long. I mean, these games take a crazy amount of time just to be put together, so...
So what's it like then to have the video come out at PlayStation and show something brand new and take people by surprise?
Oh, well, yeah, as you said, we announced the game at the Paris Games Week. And as you know, it was inspired by the short that we did before in 2012, I think,
right,
where we introduced this character of Kara with an android coming to life. And it was very interesting because people really enjoyed the short. And they wanted to know what would happen to Kara once she leave the factory, and I didn't have a clue. So this is how everything started, and I just needed to imagine the story from there. That was the starting point for Detroit.
When you made the short, did you imagine your next game was going to be something completely different?
No,
did you have an idea?
Absolutely not, because actually when we worked on the short, it was just supposed to be a technical demo. I just needed to write something very quickly because we wanted to test how far we could go with emotions, and so the specs was, let's write something where we have a character going through very different emotions in 5 minutes. So that was the specs, and this is how I wrote the short. And then I wanted to expand this story, and I was really haunted by this question: what happens to Kara? Where does she go when she leaves the factory? And we started working on Detroit that way, and thought that maybe one character was great, but I wanted to go back to somehow what I did on Heavy Rain, telling a story from different perspectives with different characters through different eyes. And here we are at E3 introducing our second character called Connor.
Now, great name. Now, the question then for me becomes is the story that they're all mixed up in more than just, are androids alive? Of course, we had the Origami Killer in Heavy Rain. That was like unified all the different parts. Is this one just about android rights, or is there more to it?
Well, we tried to create a very complex story through multiple characters. And of course, the story starts separated. So you start playing Kara, and the next scene is going to be with Connor. And maybe, who knows, maybe there are other characters. But of course, all the stories will blend and tell the big story.
Okay.
So this format allows us to talk about many different things, many different topics. And what we want to do with Detroit is not so much to create another story about AI or technology. We want to talk about human beings. We want to talk about us, about our society, about our present, our past, maybe our future. But we want to talk about human emotions. That's the most important thing for us. So that was one very important thing in the writing. And the second important thing was to say, there have been many stories where they were taking the point of view of humans and saying, oh, androids are the bad thing, they are the virus, and they want to destroy us, and we need to win. And I just wonder what would happen if they were the good guys, and maybe the humans are the bad guys. Maybe we are in a declining society. Maybe we become selfish. Maybe we become more dependent to technology. What if they were the right thing?
Oh, yeah.
Tell me about Detroit as a setting, because in the United States, Detroit is looked at, frankly, as a very hyper-decaying city, a city that's being abandoned, basically. I noticed that it looked like to me that GM towers, for instance, are there, like, but the city's been revitalized. Can you tell me a little bit about the reality of Detroit during this setting? Like, what happens? Is it that AI becomes the new car manufacturing base there?
Well, you know I'm French, and...
No!
yes,
you?
I am.
Yeah, no idea.
You didn't guess. Okay, good. Maybe I have a different perspective on the city and the history of Detroit, but I was very fascinated by the story of this city. That was a big titan of the 20th century and went through hard times. And I thought that if the Android industry had to be born somewhere, they would probably need huge factories and a lot of space and just go somewhere. And I thought that Detroit would be the perfect place for that. But it's also a great city for its cultural background. Music is fantastic in Detroit, of course. There is Motown, and many artists were born there. And there's a lot going on. So we traveled to Detroit because we didn't want to write about a city from Paris, you see what I mean. So we spent a lot of time there, of course, taking pictures, and we visited the abandoned factories and the abandoned churches. But at the same time, we met the people, and we were very surprised by the energy there. And the fact that there are people who want to build something new here. And there's a lot of energy, and there's definitely something happening in Detroit. That's how we felt when we went there. And I thought that all this combined made it the perfect background for the story that I wanted to tell. That was really, it's a very human story, Detroit as a city. It's a very human story.
Sure.
And it was the perfect background for my story.
Nice. Chris, we're hogging him. Talk to David Cage.
Well, you know what I'm curious
about,
talk
to David Cage all day long.
Couldn't we all? What I'm curious about is, you know, you have Heavy Rain, you've got a couple different characters that the player is spreading their sort of agency between. And then you go to Beyond, and it's really just the two. And now with Detroit, you're spreading it back out beyond more than two characters, I'd imagine. What have you sort of learned from that narrowing of focus with Beyond that you're carrying through to how you're giving the player agency across multiple characters in Detroit?
Well, you know, I mean, we always try to find the best way to tell the story we want to tell. And sometimes it's multiple characters because we want different points of view. Sometimes it's on Beyond, it was logical to tell the story of one character because we wanted to talk about different moments in their life. Mm-hmm. Detroit needed different angles. And because we wanted to tell the story from different perspectives. And just make these stories, these individual stories, tell the big story. Mm-hmm. And we also know that people really enjoy being in the shoes of different characters and switching from one to the other and just facing different situations and different dilemmas. Mm-hmm. And this is exactly what we want to offer them on Detroit.
And, you know, given what we were talking about earlier about the character of Detroit, the city, and sort of the rejuvenation that you are in the version you're imagining.
Yes.
To tell the story of a city, you do need those multiple perspectives. You need people in different social strata, in different roles, and different places. So it seems like those things intertwine.
Yeah, absolutely. It expands the scope. It allows you to tell a bigger story somehow. That's exactly the type of tone and intention that we wanted for this story in particular.
Well, speaking of bigger story, you guys had the trailer, the presentation during the press conference yesterday. You really went at showing a visual representation of all the branching dialogue stuff, all the branching opportunities, branching ways that, you know, Quantic Dream has done so well in their previous games. Talk about that scope and sort of how you're evolving that system in terms of your gameplay design approach.
Well, our ambition for Detroit is really to create the most bending story ever created by the studio. So we really want to give a lot of consequences to player actions. And basically, we don't want the player just to be the actor of the story. We want him to become the co-writer of the story. So we create this kind of narrative space, mm-hmm. and we want the player to play within this narrative space and tell his own story through his own decisions and his own choices. And this is really what we try to create. So it's very complex to write, to be honest with you. Because it very quickly becomes a mess.
Yeah, I can imagine.
Because there are tons of things and you want to be absolutely consistent on the consequences that you give. You want them to surprise the player, but at the same time to be logical. And you want many of them. So we just show one scene, and just this very first scene has like more than six outcomes that will have an impact later in the game. So if you combine all the scenes together, you realize that it can become very quickly very complex. Yeah.
The mind always reels when you try to wrap your head around what you guys
I don't understand how you write it.
I don't understand either.
I worry about the platinum trophy. How hard is it going to be to get this platinum trophy?
The Heavy Rain platinum. We both got the Heavy Rain platinum.
Yeah. We had Excel documents. We had to go through.
It was like a beautiful mind over there, like in our living room with all these things. One of the things I'm always fascinated with you is you guys really, you have a big name. David Cage is a big name. Quantum Dream's a big name. That you guys make good games. I find it impossible to believe that for other first parties and third parties have not gone after you for games. Why do you keep going back to Sony? What is it about Sony and working with PlayStation that makes you want to stay in that ecosystem? Because you could very easily make multi-platform games.
You know, we came here at E3 10 years ago for the first time with Sony. We came with this short demo called The Casting that would become Heavy Rain later.
Yeah.
And that was exactly 10 years ago. It was in 2006. So we have a very long-lasting relationship with Sony as a publisher. What I personally really enjoy working with them is the freedom they give me, the creative freedom. And they support the fact that we try things and that we don't always succeed. Sometimes we'll look for something, we'll try something, you know what, doesn't work. But that's okay because we try different things. And that's what I love the most about them is their constant support over the past 10 years. And the fact that they let us try things and try to discover new ideas.
And what about PlayStation 4 specifically? I mean, is this the power of this machine compared to the PS3 where your last two games lived? Has this helped you tell your story more? Has the power really helped you, or do you not necessarily need it like you would need to make, say, a Killzone game or something like that?
You know, I don't think that you need the best technology to create emotion. I mean, you can create emotion with very simple things, actually. Technology just makes things more real, for sure. Somehow, at least the way you look at them, it also makes everything more complex in many ways, because then production becomes incredibly difficult, and then you need to scan actors, and you need to have performance capture, and you want the right rendering, and lighting needs to be perfect. So it makes attention to detail much more important. But at the same time, I don't think that technology is absolutely required to create emotion. Sure. It's just another tool. More colors on your palette, but that's it.
Do you miss when it was simpler, when it wasn't so hard and there's shaders and lighting and scanning and there's a million things? Because I have to imagine, like, I asked you at the beginning, you've been working on it too long.
Yeah, you know, these games become very complex because, yes, we have very high ambition for it and we try to create something new. At the same time, the technology becomes more and more demanding. And I would say that the bad side of that is that the company is now 200 people. So when you work on something that tries to be different, you have a vision for it, you need to evangelize this vision across 200 people in your studio, which is more efforts for a game creator than if we were like 10 working on the same thing, and you know, it's a very different experience. So I think there are some very good sides to it, because then you have the power and you can do incredible thing and you really enjoy doing it. At the same time, keeping creative control on what's going on, sharing excitement and passion in the studio requires more time and more work.
Well, while we're on the subject of technology, showcased alongside Detroit at the Sony press conference was PSVR. So what, personally, David Cage, as a creator, what are your feelings on VR?
Honestly, before I tried it, I was kind of skeptical, thinking, okay, I see what it does, but... And I kept reading people saying, oh, it's incredible. And I said, okay, I need to test it. So
sure, yeah.
We checked different systems and, of course, Morpheus from Sony. And I realized that, yeah, it's really something different. It's really a new platform. Mm-hmm. It's a new approach to interactivity in many ways. And I think you really need to see it as a different platform and not just saying, oh, can I port my game and make it work with VR? No, I think you need to design for this medium and really probably think about game design in a very different way.
Absolutely. And I think one of the most exciting things, at least for me, as we get to see all these sort of VR experiences, is quickly sort of started building your own mental database of experiences like that. How are developers doing new things here? It's a new it's a new platform, it's almost a new language of game design, and seeing that kind of stuff, I mean, definitely puts me in mind of when is David Cage gonna be gonna be giving me some in VR?
Let him finish. Let him finish Destroy.
Yes, please.
All right.
You're gonna give him a heart attack. I'm not saying I want it right now, but you know, I'm intrigued.
Down the road for
I'm
sure. For sure.
No, it's a very interesting platform, but it has its own challenges.
Yeah.
And you really need to find new answers, which is very challenging for any game creator. Like, okay, that's a new challenge. How am I going to solve this?
Mm-hmm.
And you need to find new answers because all the old answers, I don't think they will work on this new platform.
I agree.
David Cage.
Oh.
Thank you so much for coming by.
Thank you for having me.
You said you'd announce the release date, so when is Detroit Become Human coming out?
It's not announced yet. You almost had him.
I almost had him. Did I say that?
He's maybe so tired from rewriting and rewriting.
Yeah, I know, right.
He almost gave me that. Real quick, can you say that it's 2017, or is it you can't even say that much?
What I can say is that it's not going to be this year.
Okay.
Cool. Well, that's 1 year knocked off. From here on out, you'll figure out the rest. Ladies and gentlemen, give it up for David Cage. Detroit coming eventually. And of course, keep it here on GameSpot.com or YouTube.com/kindoffunnygames, wherever you're watching this, for more E3 2016 coverage.
You're watching the GameSpot co-op stage, sponsored by LEGO Star Wars, The Force Awakens.